This is Voices USA Brazil talk show, and today we have the honor to interview Eve.
I'm so excited to be here with you, Alex, and great to be with Lillian. I've only seen both of you via Zoom, so I can't wait until I can see you and give you a good hug.
It'll be nice. It'll be the days, won't it, when we can do that again?
Yes.
And Lillian, now is
thank you for inviting me, Alex. It's really cool being here today.
Now, Lillian is so special for me. She was really a reason why I am getting my associate.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I can tell you, Lillian is one of our most beloved professors on campus.
Aww.
And I hear alumni all the time who rave about her public speaking class, and she is such a genuine person and cares so much and is a very active member of our governance, our shared governance structure here, and someone whom I really admire as a person. So I couldn't think of a better person to share this imaginary stage with right now.
Thank you so much, Eve.
And we're also proud of your accomplishments, Alex. It's not been easy, but you are so tenacious and you have such a big heart. You care so much about this community, and I am just in awe in terms of your generosity of spirit. You are just one of these people who gives and gives and gives and gives so joyfully. I am glad that the universe brought us all together.
Oh, man. Thank you so much. Thank you. One of the first questions is your background, your family background. If you can talk about your education, too.
But my family is a very big part of my life. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be where I am without them. I have two children and a husband, and they're the nucleus of our family. But family for me is much broader. So being an immigrant, I left most of my family in Haiti when I was 12 years old. So the people who became my family in the U.S. were people who were essentially strangers when we first met, who had nothing to gain by helping us, by loving us, and by creating community with us. And so my definition of family is very expansive. And of course, we have in-laws, and our family is very diverse across all dimensions of diversity. And it makes it for very rich and fun and culturally diverse, artistically diverse. The food that we cook, the languages that we speak, the cultures that we celebrate and that we embrace as our family grows bigger. It's just been really wonderful. I wouldn't be here without them. And of course, I have my GCC family. You're part of that. And mm-hmm. Lillian is a part of that. And during these difficult times, especially, family sustains us. And I've been very grateful to have the GCC family and the broader Western Mass family, the folks who have embraced us and who have helped to make this area home for us. I'm very grateful for that. And I know that my husband and our kids are also.
Eve, might I ask how that transition happened from Haiti to the United States? What motivated you to do that?
Well, I was a kid, frankly. I was 12 years old. My parents had come first to the US, and my dad first and my mom. And then I'm the oldest of seven. My brother comes right after me came, and we were pretty much in charge of everything. We lived in a boarding house with my uncle. So if you can imagine, just one room, two adults, two kids, and with other rented rooms in that apartment in Dorchester. That's where we lived for a while. I lived there when I was in the sixth grade and the seventh grade. And we were responsible for everything. I was responsible for everything. A few years later, my parents were able to bring over my four other siblings. And they came and we moved to a two-bedroom apartment, again, very crammed. You know, the typical immigrant story, and being the girl and being the oldest child, I was very early on, from the time I was 14, 15, in charge of the whole family. So I cooked the meals, I did the grocery shopping. We didn't have a washer and a dryer. I took the clothes to the laundromat. I mean, you name it, I did it. I was the parent. I took my sister to daycare before I went to school, picked her up at night, cooked the meals, you know, the whole thing. So, you know, in some ways it was hard, and in other ways, it gave me very good discipline and taught me some very good lessons and gave me some great skills. So I've been managing budgets since I was about 15 years old. So I'm very frugal, I'm very resourceful, and I also know how to take care of people. I've been waking up at, you know, 3-4 o'clock since I was maybe 16 years old. So it's a habit that hasn't died. And of course, it has a lot of merits. It's allowed me to be very productive over the years. And, you know, you're right. Resilient.
You moved to here when you were 12 years old, right? Yes. You moved to Boston? No.
Yes. Yes. Wow. Yeah. We moved to Boston. I lived in the greater Boston area for 25 years. We lived 26 years. We lived in Boston proper for 12 years, and then we lived in Metro West in Maynard, Massachusetts for 14 years. So, you know, it is still home in many ways for my children. Whenever they think of home, we've moved around a couple of times in the last few years. They think of the house that they were born in, the house that they grew up in, you know, the swimming pool, the yards, their friends, We try to keep them connected because that's family to them also.
Okay. Wow. But when you're 12, so you moved when you're 12. So, and how do you remember your home hometown? You remember your home country?
Oh,
how,
yeah.
The memory you have, like.
Yeah. I mean, I think growing up in Haiti, the first 12 years of my life, and also here in the US, in Dorchester, some of the rougher parts of Boston, have really shaped who I am. I think my commitment to social justice, my commitment to equity, to education, to higher education as a path to transform lives and impact multiple generations and create a more equitable and more just world. All of these values that I hold are derived from my early experiences, both in Haiti and growing up in Dorchester and then Rosendale and Jamaica Plain in Eastern Mass.
How is your relationship with Haiti today? Like, you have a family there?
Yeah, I have family there. My husband and I continue to support family members and other folks with higher education. We are sending a second person through medical school, and this person is not a family member. We just want to make a difference. We've been there twice with our kids. We'd like to go again next year because they were so little when they went. Our son was 7 months old when he went, and we were there for 2 months. Our daughter was, I think the second time we went, I want to say she was 3 and our son was 5. So they have some memories, but not a lot. And one of the good things we've been doing during COVID is to cook a lot of Haitian dishes and to speak a lot of Haitian Creole, especially with my son. He speaks a number of languages, but Haitian Creole has not been his best. So we've really been practicing.
Which teacher influenced you the most as a student, and why?
Oh gosh. This is a person who's been with me forever. I have two. I would say the first is Mr. Holmes, who was my middle school teacher in the eighth grade. So in the eighth grade, I transitioned from bilingual to mainstream education. And, you know, my family wasn't very involved in the school. They would come on school nights, but pretty much my parents just left us to do our homework. We knew what to do. And I was a very shy, awkward kid. And Mr. Holmes made me feel visible. He was such a great teacher. And I was kind of a teacher's pet. So during Lunch, I would always hang out with him. He always had cafeteria duty, and I would talk to him about Jeopardy. We both watched Jeopardy, and we would talk about the episode from the night before. He was my social studies teacher, and you know, we joked, we laughed, and in fact, when I was doing my doctorate degree, I sought him out, and I've lost his phone number now, but for some time, we were in touch, and he was definitely the most influential teacher in my life while I was still in school. And I would say during my undergrad years, right after I went to college, right after I started college, I went back to my high school. I went to Boston Latin School, which is the oldest high school in America, very prestigious. And as we like to say, sumus primi, we are number one. You know, you study 4 to 6 years of Latin, like great that. School, great education. Taught me a lot about American society and disparities and all kinds of things. I reconnected with a French teacher from Boston Latin School. Her name is Michelle Lepietre, and she is just this amazing French-German woman, very strong. And I would have to say that she influenced so much who I am as a woman, who I am becoming as a woman. And as I've gotten older, I've realized how much she and I have in common, how much we think alike, and how much of the same convictions and personality we have. And when I'm with her and her family, you know, it's family. I lived with her for a while and her two girls, and it's just this place where I can go and escape and be me and know that these are the people I love and who love me unconditionally. So teachers are so important. My dad was a teacher. My mom is a childcare provider. So teachers run in our family.
Is that why you decided to go into education?
You know, I never saw myself going into education.
Really?
So yeah, I always aspired to be a lawyer. Believe it or not.
Oh, yes. Your story is so similar to mine, Eve. I cannot believe it. I grew up in the Bronx in a really rough neighborhood. I had an inspirational teacher, and I was the teacher's pet, and I was going to be a lawyer.
Great. Look, we're learning so much about each other here. Yeah, I always wanted to be a lawyer, and I also wanted to be a diplomat. And I realized when I was my last year in college that I didn't want to be a lawyer anymore, and I wanted to study economics. So that's what I did. I went to the London School of Economics and studied economics, which I really enjoyed, and then came back, and it was 2001, and it was really hard to find a job. And eventually I did find a job doing applying statistics, which was a burgeoning passion of mine at the Massachusetts Department of Education, which is now called DESE, and Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. Education was really ignited. And then from there, I decided to get my PhD in education statistics. So yeah, it's just sort of gradually grew, you know, from being a political science and international relations major to studying economics and studying stats in an educational context. And So I'd say I fell into education and fell into higher ed, but it's been the most rewarding career, and you know, where I see myself giving more of my skills and knowledge and certainly passion.
It was not your plan to become a president of a college,
but no.
How you came to GCC, how it's happened. And I want to say one thing about the, I always thought about, like, if I could, I would send a message to everyone who chose you. I always think about the people who chose you.
You can send that message to Lillian. I think she was one of the ones who chose me.
I see a lot of people very happy with your extremely hard work. It is incredible how, so sometimes I feel like I don't think, well, I know that I heard that you don't sleep a lot.
That is the rumor, that you don't sleep.
Is that true?
That is true. I mean, you know, it's from my youth. I've always
Yes.
I've always gotten up very early in the morning, and I get a lot of things done. And, you know, I think,
take care of so many things, and the sense of responsibility. It's the same sense of responsibility you have now. So much like you used to have a small family, now you have a huge family. We are in a very difficult time right now. What you can say about this moment?
Well, you know, I think it's a very tough time everywhere. It's a very tough time in our world. It's a very tough time in our country. It's a very tough time in our state. You know, we see Wuhan opened a month ago or a month and a half ago, and now so many people have gotten sick and they're testing. So it's such a precarious time. And I think living here in Franklin County in the Pioneer Valley, which have some of the poorest regions in the state, some of the poorest counties in the state, it's very difficult. And we are doing our best at GCC. We're also doing our best in this community. I have to say that I have just been so moved and so heartened to see the extent to which people have extended themselves to our students, to the community. When you look at the sense of cohesion, when you look at the heart, when you look at the sense of humanity that is so pervasive across our communities here, it's hard not to feel loved. Not to feel loved and not to feel love. And it's hard to sit back and say that you don't want to help. So I think each one of us is helping in the ways that we can, while at the same time trying to give a sense of normalcy, especially those of us who are in leadership positions. We know that times are hard. And as a leader, for me, it's important to be there for the people who are trusting me to make the best decisions on behalf of the college. And it's also important to give people a voice, to seek their counsel, because from my vantage point, there's only so much that I can see. There's so much that I cannot see. And there are people who have a history at the college, who've been here for much longer, and who also have insights and skills and expertise in areas that I don't, and who also have lived experiences that can help inform the decisions that we make. So one of the things that I've been really adamant about doing is holding office hours, is holding all college meetings, is continuing with our governance meetings to make sure that people have an avenue where they can give input, give feedback, give critique. And at the same time, also holding social hours, that we can have a time where we can relax, decompress, have a drink, enjoy your favorite food, tell jokes, be silly, wear silly hats, and to just, you know, relax and breathe and enjoy the sense of community that we have on campus, and to see how we can replicate that a little bit online. So these are really tough times. I think most of us have not experienced a global pandemic. We are learning. And I also think that we are learning how to be more resilient, how to be stronger, because the world, when we open back up fully, will not be what we were accustomed to. It will be drastically different. And at GCC, we are preparing for that world, and we have been preparing for that world as we began our strategic planning to be much more resilient, much more adaptive, much more flexible, innovative, et cetera. But certainly, you know, the global pandemic has thrown a wrench into things. And we are learning, we are tightening our belts, and we're keeping sight of our goals and moving forward. It's a tough time.
Eve, what made you decide to choose GCC?
You know, it's about my values. It was when I came on campus. First of all, I have to say, so very few people know the story. When the headhunter called me and said, you should definitely apply for this job, I said, oh, I'm not so sure. It's a small school. It's rural. I love rural, but it's very small. And I'm not so sure I want to be the president of another small school. I was at a small school that was 4,000, and this one was half the size. And the prior school where I was in Eastern Mass was an 8,000 student school. So I've just been gradually getting smaller. And he said, you know, I think you will love it. I think it's a great fit for you. Why don't you take a look, do your research. So I looked and I said, oh, wow, these values really align with mine and with my family's. Because for me, it was really important to uproot my family from New Jersey, it had to be the right fit. And certainly being in Massachusetts was nice because we'd be closer to our family, but it was really important that it could be a place where my husband was happy, my kids were happy, and that it made sense. And so the more I read, the more I said, okay, this looks like a great fit. And I actually didn't submit my resume until the night before it was due. So it was due on Monday, and on Sunday night was when I submitted my application package. And then when I came on campus, I just fell in love with the campus. I fell in love with the people. I fell in love with their values. I felt so at home. I felt like it was a great fit. And I felt like I want to be here. I want this job. And so from that point, it was just, you know, how do I demonstrate to the committee and the rest of the decision makers that I would be a great fit? And also, how do I get more of a sense of the culture to be really sure that this is where I wanted to be? So Lillian, let me ask you this question.
Okay.
What did you see in me as a candidate?
Oh, I saw all kinds of hope and opportunity. I saw energy and vibrancy. I saw diversity, and I saw the future.
Yeah. You have this incredible smile that it probably gets everybody. Yeah,
your
smile. I'd like to ask Lillian, what made you choose GCC?
It's a really good question because it's so similar to Eve. It's a little bit spooky. I'd always come from basically urban areas. I wanted to be in an urban area in a big school. And GCC was the exact opposite of that. But I was so impressed with the school once I arrived at the school. And then I was very fortunate in that I had other job offers. So I had the opportunity to make a decision. And I was pretty sure I was going to take a job in Boston because that's what I was accustomed to. But it kept nagging at me how comfortable I felt on the GCC campus. So I thought what I would do, because this was very early in my career, I would stay at GCC for a few years. And then, of course, I would go to a city where I belonged. Well, 28 years later, I'm still at GCC, and it was the best choice I ever made.
Oh, so, that's great. That's great. Yeah.
And now
how about you, Alex?
I love GCC. I love GCC, and I think you can see how much I love GCC.
Yes, and it's evident.
I love because at first GCC always treat me very well. I was always very well cared of. Like every time I went to GCC, because it's hard, and I have my difficulties, and also when I get like emotional, nerves or something. Now my English it gets really weird sometimes, and so it's hard for me. It's hard to know you. It's your second language, and you go to college. You want to study, and you get in a reception and say hi, and it's so much attention. Now it's so difficult, and we don't know what we're gonna find. And then I get there, I was always very well treated, and it's not always like that because I went to others, a community college too, and also good because my experience with education in the United States is really good everywhere, but GCC has something different, something mm-hmm. special. It's like it's really the sense of that I am in an area that, I don't know. It's mostly it's a piece. It becomes it's a building that becomes a piece of you. You walk
Absolutely.
Around, you go in. It's incredible. The sense
it becomes
of
becomes home.
Yeah, it's yep. it's the I love it. I love it. GCC and Greenfield Markets. Those are my
two institutions in Greenfield for certain.
Oh, I love it. There's so many things here. There's so many. I believe so much in education. I would say to everybody, you know, this is a moment. This is a moment because, you know, in crisis, what the first thing you do, you call your mom and you go to school.
Very smart.
I was just wondering, what would you say is the most rewarding part of being in education?
The students, and I think if you aggregate that, the impact that we have in the community. So being at a community college, I love community colleges, and I love this college in particular, is that we have this dual mission of higher education attainment for at the individual level, and we also have the workforce and economic development at the community level. So to see students graduate, to see them go through the trials and tribulations, to see them get the excitement, to see how they achieve the small steps that lead them to commencement, to see the joys that they feel, to see what they learn, to give them hugs and to see them pop into the office and for them to really begin to imagine who they are becoming, and to begin to envision what the world of possibilities is for them is just tremendously rewarding. And also one of the reasons why I believe in mentors. You know, you had asked earlier, Alex, you know, what made me want to be a college president? I never wanted to be a college president, but I had mentors who saw that I could do that and who were so enthusiastic about me doing that and who were so persuasive and who really built me up. And so to do the same for students and students, many of them are first generation college students who don't have role models in their families. It's incredibly rewarding. And then to see how we transform the community, helping people get jobs, helping them provide for their families. I know for me, my job gives me a deep sense of fulfillment. If I couldn't provide for my family, I think it would take away my identity. You know, it doesn't matter what I do. I don't have to be a president. I could do anything. You know, there's nothing that is beneath me. To be able to take care of one's family, to have a job, to have a meaningful job, and one that allows you the financial possibility to do that, to me is so rewarding. And so to see how communities grow because people are able to prosper at the individual levels, they're able to participate in civic life because they're not working 2-3 jobs, putting food on the table and putting a roof over their heads and taking care of the basic necessities. When our communities are economically vibrant, it allows for democracy to thrive. And those are the things that make higher education rewarding for me.
What would you say is the most challenging part of being in education?
You know, it's the flip side. It's people, right? We don't have an infinite level of resources. We're not Harvard. We don't have billions of dollars in endowment. You know, right now it's challenging because I know that our people are stretched and they are working a lot. It took a lot of work, you know, Lillian, to bring the courses from face-to-face to online. Mm-hmm. It took an incredible amount of effort and people continued to give of our students because it was a bigger disruption for them as it was, even though it was a big disruption for us. So providing support for them that reaches beyond the academic support, understanding that psychosocially they are going through a lot, especially with the physical distancing, not seeing the people who may prop them up, the people who support them, the basic human interactions like touch and being able to look someone in the eye, to be comforted, all of that they bring into the classroom. Right? And if they've lost their jobs and can't provide for the basic needs, they bring that too into the classroom. Mm-hmm. So that's also the hard part. And being in public higher ed, you're always working against the margin. So thinking about sustainability while you are at the margin all the time, it makes it challenging. So we have to be resourceful. We have to be innovative and you know, we have to roll up our sleeves and get it done. And sometimes I know some of my colleagues in four-year institutions say, my gosh, you're doing that as a president? Don't you have someone who does that? You know, why are you doing this? You know, and it's just the nature of the work and also what gives it meaning.
because you can't wait, you got to do it, right?
Yeah, or we just don't have the luxury. We're very, you know, we're very lean. There's not a lot of fat there. And there aren't people to, you know, sort of pass things on to.
So. To you, how is a, I think a two question. One is like, how this transition to, I'm impressed with the transition to online was incredible. Like we just, because I'm in class right now and we just went to online, like in 1 week, we all online. and it's great. It's working well. And what do you think about this? How you see the change? Like, do you have clue of what's changed? I know it's a hard question, but I don't know.
Yeah, well, that's what we want, right? From your perspective as a student, for you to feel like we just waved a magic wand and it all got done. And that's what we want. And I give kudos to our faculty because they are the ones who made that happen. And our IT department purchased all the equipment, made it possible for faculty to do that and for students who got computers and hotspots. So we want you as a student to feel like we just waved a magic wand. But in the back, it took a lot of work and it took people working, you know, 12, 14 hour days. It took calling here, calling there, being on campus, making sure that things are working, folks delivering laptops and hotspots to students at their homes, you know, and faculty and staff figuring out how do we, in a safe way, bring people to get these computers. When you get a computer, how do you image it so that people can use it? And you're getting a lot of these things at the same time, a lot of these computers, and also making sure that folks are able to, en masse, get onto our systems remotely without crashing it. And at the same time, what people also didn't see is that we were getting a lot of intruders who were trying to break into our systems. So yes, sometimes we get the annoying emails, but what we don't see is what happens behind the scenes, that people are trying to perforate our systems, and they know that we're not paying attention to those things at this time because we're all concerned with the academic transition. So it made it hard, and also not just the classes, we transition advising, admissions, counseling, tutoring, all of the services that would typically be offered in person, we transitioned those to online. So those two had their own challenges in making sure that we could ensure the smooth transition for students, getting licenses, getting software, getting lab kits, all of these things for classes to be able to operate online, and videos and, you know, things like that, so that we can still have field experiences, remote field experiences for students. So it's been a tremendous effort, but certainly worth it. And I think we've done pretty well.
It was definitely challenging, but also it was so rewarding to see how well the students were able to transition. Not everyone, but in these difficult times, you know, just to make it to the end, I think is quite an accomplishment. And it made every minute worthwhile just to see that.
No, and also I know if we have the enrollment, right? It's don't know, today or tomorrow or something.
Enrollment has already started. So summer session one starts on May 20th, and summer session two, I believe, starts on July 5th. I'm not so sure. Could be July 5th. I could be wrong. Or July 13th. Okay. I could be wrong. I can't, but I know that summer session one starts on May 20th.
Eve, did you have something you wanted to say to the audience?
I guess the only thing I would say is that I feel very lucky to be part of this community, very welcomed, and I am so grateful for the level of the love, the care, the passion that people have for their community college. And it's so nice to see that in these difficult times that people understand that higher education is a pathway to a more vibrant, a more resilient community, a more prosperous community, and a more civically engaged community. And that folks understand and have invested in the high quality education that GCC offers. And it's just been a great experience, and I'm proud of who we are as a community. And I want to uphold the legacy of my predecessors.
I just want to thank you so much.
Well, Alex, I want to say thank you so much for being an incredible host. I've been to your country once. My husband and I spent 15 days in Rio once. I would love to go back. Your country is so vast, so beautiful. I love the fruits. I love the beach. Hopefully 2021 will be kinder to us. And
I hope we can all go together, my family and yours, and then Lillian's family too.
That's right. Thank you so much. And Lillian, it was a pleasure to be here with you. And you're an incredible woman, a great professor, and so beloved in this community. And thank you for all that you do. And thanks so much for having me.
Oh, thank you, Yves.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Before we leave, can I ask one last question?
Yes.
Tell us one fun or interesting fact about you that most people don't know. Some people don't know.
I like to snorkel, and you know my love for shark, Lillian. You've added to my collection of sharks. Yeah. I love to cook. I cook a lot. I love to laugh. Let's see. Strange things. I love to dance. I don't know if people know that. I'm a trained ballroom dancer.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Ballroom dancing and Latin dancing. And swing dancing. Yeah. So there you go. You have it. You had me going through the list. And yeah.
So you're going to do a show, right?
I'd be happy to. We were planning on it, on the multi-generational dance night, but it didn't quite happen.
All right.
Here's to 2021.